From New York, this is Democracy Now!
Even before the conflict, developing countries were struggling to recover from the pandemic with record inflation, rising interest rates, and looming debt burdens. Their ability to respond has been erased by exponential increases in the cost of financing. Now, their breadbasket is being bombed.
The United Nations is warning Russia's war in Ukraine could lead to millions going hungry in the global south as the price of wheat and fertilizer soar. We'll look at the key role Russia and Ukraine play in feeding the world with Raj Patel, author of Stuffed and Starved, The Hidden Battle for the World's Food System. He'll talk about the four C's of global hunger: climate, COVID, conflict, and capitalism. Then to Afghanistan. We'll speak to Matthew Akins, author of the new book, The Naked Don't Fear the Water, an underground journey with Afghan refugees.
Imagine right now if Ukrainians, instead of being allowed to cross freely into neighboring countries, into the EU, where they don't require visas, imagine if they were being forced to cross the mountains and sea with smugglers and risk their lives just to escape this war. And that, of course, is a situation for Afghans, as it was for Syrians, as it was for people in most conflicts in the world.
We'll talk about the growing humanitarian crisis in Afghanistan with Matthew Akins, as well as his remarkable new book about traveling with Afghan refugees as they sought a safe place to live. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Russia's widened its assault on Ukraine more than 3 weeks after President Vladimir Putin ordered its troops to invade. On Friday morning, Russian missiles struck an aircraft repair plant near the civilian airport in Lviv. The attack in western Ukraine came just 50 miles from the border with Poland, a NATO member. Russian artillery fell on a secondary school and a city cultural center in a town near Ukraine's second-largest city of Kharkiv. That attack killed 23 people. Russian shells also triggered a massive fire in Kharkiv that destroyed one of the largest markets in Eastern Europe, killing at least 3 people. More strikes have hit the capital, Kyiv. In the southern Ukraine, Russian ships are shelling the Black Sea port city of Odessa in Mariupol. Officials say 30,000 residents have managed to escape, but more than 350,000 remain besieged without adequate food, water, or medicine. This is Nadezhda, a Mariupol retiree who survived a Russian strike on her apartment block.
My grandson went outside. All of us went to the street. And I was left as the last one. And then there was an explosion. We were left without anything. We are living in basements. It's a horror. What for? Tell me, what for? What are we guilty of? In whose eyes are we guilty?
At the United Nations, Political Affairs Chief Rosemary DiCarlo told the UN Security Council Thursday the UN has confirmed 726 civilians killed and nearly 1,200 injured so far during Russia's assault. Among the dead, 115 and wounded, 115 children.
Much higher. Most of these casualties were caused by the use in populated areas of explosive weapons with a wide impact area. Hundreds of residential buildings have been damaged or destroyed, as have hospitals and schools.
Meanwhile, U.S. intelligence officials say more than 7,000 Russian troops have been killed during the first 3 weeks of fighting, including young conscripts forced into Russian military service. The House of Representatives voted overwhelmingly Thursday to sever normal trade relations with Russia over its assault on Ukraine and to further sanction Belarus over its support of Russia's military. The bill now heads to the Senate, where Majority Leader Chuck Schumer has promised a speedy debate. Meanwhile, President Biden's speaking by phone with Chinese leader Xi Jinping today. Ahead of the talk, Secretary of State Tony Blinken said China will face consequences if it moves to resupply Russia's military or takes other steps to support the Ukraine invasion.
We'll make clear that China will bear responsibility for any actions it takes to support Russia's aggression, and we will not hesitate to impose costs.
The World Health Organization is warning the coronavirus pandemic is far from over, with the number of global daily cases again on the rise. Many European countries are experiencing a new surge in cases tied to BA.2, a fast-spreading subvariant of the Omicron variant. China's expanded lockdowns in major cities as it struggles to maintain its zero-COVID strategy amidst its worst outbreak since early 2020. Meanwhile, South Korea reported more than 620,000 new cases and 429 deaths Thursday alone. Until this year, South Korea had one of the world's most successful responses to COVID-19. Here in the United States, the head of President Biden's coronavirus task force is stepping down. The White House says Jeff Zients will be replaced by Ashish Jha, the dean of the Brown University School of Public Health. Zients drew praise early in Biden's presidency for his science-based approach to the pandemic, but drew fire for failing to make rapid antigen tests and N95 masks widely available and affordable to the public. He also killed a proposal that would have provided paid quarantine and isolation for most U.S. workers. In a statement, Public Citizen said, quote, "The Zients-led COVID response refused to challenge Big Pharma's monopoly control in the U.S. and globally over technologies that relied crucially on public support. As a result, the United States and other rich countries failed to expand vaccine supply sufficient to meet global need." An Australian appeals court has overturned a historic 2021 ruling that found the government had a duty of care to protect children from the effects of the climate catastrophe. The case was brought by Australian teenagers in a bid to prevent the expansion of a coal mine. The young plaintiffs could still appeal the ruling. This comes as seven youth climate activists in Utah launched a new suit against their state and Utah officials this week. They argue fossil fuel development violates their constitutional rights and poses an existential threat to Utah's children. A U.S. federal appeals court ruled the Biden administration can factor in the cost of the climate crisis in policy decisions. The decision stays a ruling from a lower court, which banned the administration from considering what is referred to as the social cost of carbon. It could affect upcoming decisions on oil and gas drilling leases and regulatory practices. Sprawling Saharan sandstorms cast an orange glow across European skies this week. The effect was most dramatic in Spain, where authorities urge residents to stay indoors to avoid breathing in the coarse particulate matter. Scientists warn the climate crisis will intensify such events in the coming years. In Western Sahara, a delegation of U.S.-based volunteers has arrived at the home of the prominent Sahrawi human rights defender Sultana Khaya, her sister Luara, and their family. It's a rare visit by international human rights observers to the territory, which has suffered under Moroccan occupation since 1975. The U.S. delegation includes Adrian Kinney, a former U.S. Army intelligence officer and president of Veterans for Peace. Their visit breaks a 482-day siege of the home, where family members have been forcibly confined by Moroccan security forces since November of 2020. The Khaya sisters say they were raped last year by Moroccan agents in front of their 84-year-old mother. The agents also stole mobile phones, destroyed belongings, and threw trash, urine, and noxious black liquid into the family's drinking water storage tank. To see our interview with Sultana Khaya, go to our website, democracynow.org, and link to our documentary, 4 Days in Western Sahara, Africa's Last Colony. In East Timor, voters are heading to the polls Saturday. Among a field of 16 presidential candidates are incumbent Francisco Luolo Guterres of the Revolutionary Front for an Independent East Timor and former President José Ramos Horta, a Nobel Peace Prize winner. Ramos Horta has been leading in the polls. The winner will take office May 2022, the 20th anniversary of East Timor's independence from Indonesia. Peru's top court has authorized the release of 83-year-old former President Alberto Fujimori from prison. Fujimori has served less than 15 years of a 25-year sentence for human rights abuses and crimes committed during his rule in the 1990s, including kidnapping, bribery, and ordering massacres by death squads. The government of President Pedro Castillo said it would appeal the ruling before the Inter-American Court of Human Rights. Protesters took to the streets following the news. This is Gisela Ortiz Ortiz, former Peruvian culture minister whose brother was murdered during Fujimori's dictatorship.
We spontaneously came out to react to this unjust and illegal decision from the Constitutional Tribunal, which gives Fujimori freedom. He is a former president who violated human rights. We are demanding that our right to justice as massacre victims' relatives is guaranteed.
A judge in Honduras has granted the extradition of former President Juan Orlando Hernandez to the United States on drug trafficking and firearms charges. Hernandez is a longtime U.S. ally who ended his presidential term less than 2 months ago. He's also accused of accepting millions of dollars in bribes to shield drug traffickers from the law. In a court filing, witnesses say the ex-president said he wanted to shove cocaine, quote, right up the noses of the gringos. A warning to our audience. The following story contains graphic footage of police violence. In Los Angeles, newly released video shows the death of Edward Bronstein at the hands of California Highway Patrol officers. The 38-year-old father of five was arrested in March of 2020 on suspicion of driving under the influence and brought to a CHIP station in the Los Angeles suburb of Altadena. A 17-minute video recorded by a police sergeant opens with officers demanding Bronstein give a blood sample to measure his blood alcohol level.
You're bringing the fight to this, not us.
I'm not fighting it at all.
Then have a seat and provide your arm. This is your last opportunity. Otherwise, you're going face down on the mat, and we're going to keep on going.
After Bronstein hesitates, five officers tackle and pin him to the ground, pressing their combined body weight into Bronstein's back and neck.
I'll do it willingly, as told you. Please don't. Okay. I'll do it willingly. I'll do it willingly. I'll do it willingly, I promise.
The video shows officers ignoring Bronstein's pleas to willingly give a blood sample. He screams repeatedly and gasps, "I can't breathe," 12 times.
I can't breathe. I can't breathe. I can't breathe.
Just stop yelling.
I need to breathe.
Bronstein's screams grow quieter until he falls silent. Still, 2 minutes pass as officers continue to draw blood. One officer checks for a pulse, calls Bronstein's name, slaps him in the side of the head as he appears to be unconscious. Officers call for a paramedic, but continue to draw blood from Bronstein's limp body. More than 11 minutes after Bronstein's last screams, officers finally begin administering CPR. Bronstein's family is suing the California Highway Patrol for wrongful death, assault and battery, civil rights violations and failure to render aid. A federal judge ruled Bronstein's family had a right to view the video and make it public after California state attorneys fought to prevent its release. Bronstein's family is also demanding criminal charges for the officers involved. And in Washington, D.C., faculty at Howard University have announced they could go on strike next week over unresolved issues with their working conditions, including below living wages for non-tenured educators. This is Cyrus Hampton, a contingent faculty member who teaches full-time in Howard's English department.
We are calling on our tenured and tenure-track colleagues to stand with us and honor our picket lines during the strike. We're calling on our students, alums, and all of the HU community to support us in our effort to overcome the unfair labor practices of university leadership and to better the university as a whole.
Howard is one of the top historically black colleges and universities in the United States. Last fall, students won improvements to university housing and other concessions after they held a weeks-long sit-in protest occupying a student center on campus. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. When we come back, the United Nations is warning Russia's war in Ukraine could lead to millions going hungry in the global south as the price of wheat and fertilizer soar. We'll look at the key role Russia and Ukraine play in feeding the world with Raj Patel, author of Stuffed and Starved, The Hidden Battle for the World's Food System. Stay with us.
Не получается.
A Ukrainian pianist playing a piece by the Polish composer Frédéric Chopin in the ruins of her home outside Kyiv after it was damaged by Russian shelling. The video was recorded by her daughter, who turns her camera to show shattered glass, blown away doors, broken furniture. The video has since gone viral. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The United Nations is warning Russia's invasion of Ukraine could lead to a, quote, hurricane of hunger and a meltdown of the global food system. Wheat and fertilizer prices have soared since the war began 3 weeks ago. The UN's Food and Agricultural Organization warns global food prices could jump by 22% this year, which will have a devastating impact on the global south. Russia is the world's largest wheat and fertilizer exporter. Ukraine is the world's fifth largest wheat exporter. The two countries are also major exporters of corn and barley. Rising food prices will also contribute to higher food prices. UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres addressed the crisis earlier this week. He said the breadbasket of the developing world is being bombed.
While war reigns over Ukraine, a sword of Damocles hangs over the global economy, especially in the developing world. Even before the conflict, developing countries were struggling to recover from the pandemic with record inflation, rising interest rates, and looming debt burdens. Their ability to respond has been erased by exponential increases in the cost of financing. Now, their breadbasket is being bombed. Russia and Ukraine represent more than half of the world's supply of sunflower oil and about 30% of the world's wheat. Ukraine alone provides more than half of the world's food program's wheat supply. Food, fuel, and fertilizer prices are skyrocketing. Supply chains are being disrupted, and the costs and delays of transportation of imported goods when available are at record levels. And all of this is hitting the poorest, the hardest, and planting the seeds for political instability and unrest around the globe. Grain prices have already exceeded those at the start of the Arab Spring and the food riots of 2007-2008. The FAO's Global Food Prices Index is at its highest level ever. 45 African and least developed countries import at least one-third of their wheat from Ukraine and Russia. 18 of those countries import at least 50%. This includes countries like Burkina Faso, Egypt, Democratic Republic of the Congo, Lebanon, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, and Yemen. We must do everything possible to avert a hurricane of hunger and the meltdown of the global food system.
Those are the words of the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres earlier this week. To talk more about how Russia's war in Ukraine is leading to a global food crisis, we're joined by Raj Patel, research professor at the University of Texas, Austin, author of Stuffed and Starved, The Hidden Battle for the World's Food System, and co-director of the documentary The Ants and the Grasshopper, which focuses on agroecology, hunger, and climate change. He also serves on the International Panel of Experts on Sustainable Food Systems. So, Raj, together, Ukraine and Russia provide something like a quarter of the world's wheat. Can you talk about how Russia's invasion of Ukraine is threatening the global south?
Well, you're quite right, Amy. But between Russia and Ukraine, about 28% of the global wheat trade, measured by weight, comes from Russia and Ukraine. For some countries, like, for example, Eritrea imports 100% of its wheat from the combined sources of Russia and Ukraine. But it's not just countries that import wheat directly from these countries that are feeling the impact, because what will happen is that with the absence of these stocks available, the global price in wheat will go up, and countries will try and source that wheat from other places. But what that means is that globally, the price of wheat is going up, and that the shocks of the Ukraine invasion get propagated everywhere. And that's how you will be able to see an increase in hunger as a result of this. The United Nations has been modeling that now the global number of people who are suffering undernutrition will hit possibly 830 million people. And that's driven by a price increase, as you mentioned before, of up to 22% in global wheat markets. So what's happening is that once the supply becomes uncertain, global markets price in the uncertainty. You see wheat trading at incredibly high levels, hitting record levels earlier on this month. And that means that with high prices, you're likely to see the kinds of instability that the Secretary General was mentioning earlier on.
And talk about how the seasons work right now. I mean, we're moving into, in just a few weeks, what would be a planting season, right, in Ukraine and Russia.
Right. And so what we're seeing at the moment is that farmers, I mean, you may have seen some footage of farmers trying to get into their fields and to access some of the wheat, some of the winter wheat that's been ready for harvest and getting ready for spring planting. All of that becomes much less certain. And again, that uncertainty propagates worldwide because of the other commodity that is under threat here or that's affected, and that's fertilizer. As you mentioned in the introduction, Russia is the world's largest nitrogen fertilizer exporter, and it is also a significant exporter of potash and phosphorus. All of these are things that industrial agriculture requires in order to be able to get the yields that we're accustomed to. With the price of all these fertilizers going up, it's not just farmers in Ukraine who are suffering the impacts. Globally, farmers who are dependent on these fertilizers are starting to make decisions about planting spring crops, for instance, in North America. And the supply response isn't as robust as one might think. It's not as if farmers are heading off into the fields and deciding that they're going to cover everything with wheat, in large part because it's going to be expensive to fertilize that, and also in large part because we're already seeing a drought in large parts of the wheat belt spurred by climate change. And so the sort of combination of the global network of international commodity prices driving up the prices everywhere mean that farmers are thinking twice about whether to vastly increase the number of acres they have under wheat production.
30% of Yemen's wheat imports come from Ukraine. Shortly after Russia's invasion of Ukraine, many Yemenis rushed to buy flour and expressed concern about rising food prices. This is an example.
The Ukrainian-Russian war will affect the whole world and not just us. This war will affect import, export, and trade because we are an importer of wheat and most of the foodstuffs are from abroad. So undoubtedly, we will be affected. But we have great confidence in God that it will be resolved, God willing.
Everything is available, whether wheat or wheat flour. But we were surprised by the citizens' demand because of the Ukraine war, although it had no effect. Our country has a war, and prices are fixed as we suffer from war. But the war between Russia and Ukraine caused people's demand for wheat to increase so much that some traders raised their prices because of the great demand. Although wheat flour is available and everything is available, whether wheat or wheat flour.
Food costs have already more than doubled in many areas of Yemen in the past year. According to the UN, more than 17.4 million Yemenis are food insecure. 1.6 million in Yemen are expected to fall into emergency levels of hunger in coming months. Can you elaborate on this, Raj Patel?
Well, I mean, again, what we've seen is that this conflict is happening after a dismal 2 years of the pandemic and a sort of dismal 10 years of recovery after the last global recession. So all of this is sort of compounding one another. I mean, let's start with, if we're thinking about the drivers of hunger internationally, you can sort of remember them by thinking of four Cs. Most recently, of course, COVID, which has caused global increases in levels of hunger, not because COVID attacked cereals or that COVID in some way destroys food directly, but because COVID had a massive impact on the economies of countries around the world, particularly in the global south. And while we in the United States were able to dodge the worst of it with merely 40 million people in this country being food insecure, and somehow that's considered acceptable, globally, the number of people who are food insecure is in excess of 2.3 billion. That's a huge increase on the figures before the pandemic. So COVID, by generating poverty, also generated hunger. So on top of COVID, you've got conflict. And again, the Ukraine is obviously a major conflict, but it's not the only one. And the dynamics of conflict are invariably sort of similar in that when conflict happens, farming is disrupted, when the battlefield moves through rural areas. But it also has long-term implications for farmers, not just in sort of destroying the land and their capacity to farm, but also through the human populations that move through the land. And all of that, again, drives up hunger. The third thing, of course, to worry about is climate change. Again, you mentioned this at the top of the hour. Climate change is just getting worse. There are large parts of the world where you see, 10 years ago, we had a range of food rebellions, people taking to the streets because of the high price, in particular, of wheat. But 10 years ago, the high price of wheat was generated by a once in 500-year climatic event in Russia, a heat wave that killed tens of thousands of people directly, but then propagated these huge spikes in the price of wheat around the world. And right now, we're in the middle of many severe weather events. In Mozambique, where 10 years ago there were these food rebellions, Mozambique is just recovering from a Category 3 cyclone, Cyclone Gombe, that passed through the area and has left vast amounts of devastation. So climate change is making not just the farming of food much harder. Again, I mentioned the drought earlier on in the United States, but these extreme weather events are happening everywhere. But they're also generating displacement and generating the destruction of stocks that, again, is driving hunger. And so the fourth C in global hunger, of course, is capitalism. The way that we grow food today is not with an ambition to make sure that everyone in the world is fed in a nutritious way. The reason to grow food is to make money. And as long as food is grown in order to generate profit, rather than to end hunger, then we are structurally always going to have people who cannot afford that food. And tragically, as a result of the rise in prices, we are certain to see tens of millions more people fall into hunger, not just in Eritrea, but throughout the global south, particularly actually in Asia. The Asia-Pacific region is going to be much harder hit just because of the levels of hunger that pre-exist there. But sub-Saharan Africa is going to have it pretty tough, too.
You know, Antonio Guterres, the UN Secretary General, mentioned the Arab Spring in his speech, warning how the invasion of Ukraine can lead to deepening hunger in the world. A sharp rise in the cost of wheat coincided in 2011 with the Arab Spring. Can you talk about that juxtaposition?
So the Secretary General actually mentioned two moments of high prices and low affordability of food. So that there was a 2007-2008 spike that saw protest in places like Haiti, for instance. And then, yes, in 2010, we saw the Arab Spring begin. It triggered, in fact, by assaults on food vendors. And all of a sudden, you saw mass movements of people taking to the streets at the end of 2010, beginning of 2011, driven in part by government's inability to be able to provide affordable food when people had come to expect that. It would be reasonable to expect more protests this time around. But in the intervening years, we've not seen governments necessarily flock to the idea that what we need is grain storage. And particularly with interest rates rising, grain storage becomes increasingly expensive for countries. And instead, what we're seeing is, globally, a sort of turn to nationalism in a way that casts the working class and casts the poorest off. And so wherever you look, you find these sort of strong men around the world, whether it's Putin or Modi in India, for instance, governments presiding over catastrophic outcomes, particularly in hunger, because of COVID and because of their mismanagement of the economy. And instead of admitting that, in fact, what is needed is a redistribution of wealth and resources to the poorest, you see this national turn where it becomes criminalized to criticize the government. It becomes treasonous to say that anything other than, you know, fighting for the flag is the right thing to do. And under cover of this sort of bourgeois patriotism, the working class are being sold out. So I would fully expect to see far more protests of people taking to the street. It's not a particular prophecy that I'm making here. We've already seen protests in countries that have defaulted on their debt under the pandemic. We've seen big protests in Sri Lanka, for instance. I think it's easy to see a moment in which the forces of nationalism are up against the forces and demands of working class members of society who are up against a fairly robust patriotic and militarized response. And I worry that we will see a return, as we did in 2010, of police forces opening fire on unarmed working class people who are making a demand simply for their daily bread.
I mean, in Egypt, you have typically the world's largest wheat importer buying more than 60% of its wheat abroad. 80% of that is from Russia and Ukraine.
And exactly, although some of those shipments have managed to get through, the short to medium term prognosis is not good. Because governments have failed to learn the lesson of the past two supply shocks, and because the international development agencies have generally not said, well, the wise thing to do is for you to withdraw from the international trading system and make sure your domestic supply chains are robust. I worry with you, Amy, that we're being set up to see many more protests. In the intervening 10 years, the left has been eroded, has been under assault so systematically that I worry that the outcome is going to be a sort of revival of a certain kind of nationalism that portends violence towards the working class rather than their liberation.
Let me ask you about here at home. The Financial Times has reported the U.S. Farm Service Agency is thinking about loosening federal restrictions on land. Can you explain what exactly that means and what the effects of this would be if it happens?
Well, it's a little too early to say. I mean, I was struck by this almost throwaway line in the Financial Times where, the Financial Times was investigating, well, is the response to be able to plant more wheat here in the United States? And someone from the federal government was saying, well, we're monitoring the situation very closely. But what this might mean is that conservation easements can be violated and that more land can be put under planting. But what I'm also seeing and hearing is that farmers are not in a position to be able to take full advantage of that because, again, high fertilizer prices mean that if you start planting something, you really do have to take care of the crop in order to be able to make it economical. But if fertilizer prices are high, that's a problem. And then again, because of climate change here in the United States and because of drought in some of the grain baskets and because of the sort of violence of industrial agriculture really draining aquifers, it's not immediately clear that even if the federal government were to open up its lands to plant baby plant in a sort of echo of 2008's drill, baby, drill. It's not clear that the supply response is going to be adequate. And even if farmers did do that, it would still be 4 months until spring wheat came in. In the short term, there's very little relief that the United States is in a position to provide. But the worry, again, is that under cover of a certain kind of patriotism, there will be transfers of resources to certain kinds of stakeholders without a concomitant fall in the level of hunger globally or even here in the United States.
So, Raj Patel, we only have a minute, and I wanted to ask how the world's food system can be changed to better be prepared for crises like these, failing if it was at all possible to prevent war from happening at all.
Well, certainly a transition towards more agroecological farming, I think, is wise for so many reasons. It increases our resilience to climate change. It shortens supply chains. It makes our food system more robust against extreme weather. It relocalizes the economy in a way that can support many more jobs and ensure that there is a return to a certain kind of commitment to making sure that everyone gets fed. And, of course, this will require a a real commitment not just to land reform, but to gender equality, because, again, hunger is a globally gendered phenomenon. And this will also require reparations from the global north to the global south for the damage we've caused these global agricultural systems to be so vulnerable in the first place. We have the solutions, but I think embracing the full sweep of a transformative agroecological shift in food systems is very doable. We have the policies, we know what to do, and what we have to do is fight for the political change to make that possible.
Raj Patel, I want to thank you for being with us. Research professor, University of Texas, Austin, author of Stuffed and Starved, The Hidden Battle for the World's Food System. Coming up, we speak to Matthew Akins, author of the new book, The Naked Don't Fear the Water, An Underground Journey with Afghan Refugees. Stay with us. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. As we turn now to Afghanistan, the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, Filippo Grandi, visited the Afghan capital of Kabul this week and urged the international community not to neglect Afghanistan, where more than half the population is experiencing acute hunger.
When the entire attention of the world is focused on Ukraine, and, by the way, on the refugee crisis that Ukraine, the Ukraine war is producing, and rightly so, because it's big, it's serious, I thought it was important to pass the message that other situations, which also require political attention and resources, should not be forgotten and neglected, especially Afghanistan.
Afghanistan has faced a looming humanitarian crisis since the Taliban took control last August, with millions on the brink of starvation. The UN Refugee Agency says 3.4 million Afghans are internally displaced. Another 2.6 million Afghans have fled Afghanistan as refugees. To discuss all of this, we spoke to the award-winning journalist Matthew Akins, contributing writer for The New York Times Magazine, who's reported on the U.S. occupation and war in Afghanistan since 2008. He's written a remarkable new book. It's called The Naked Don't Fear the Water, An Underground Journey with Afghan Refugees. In his New York Times essay, headlined We've Never Been Smuggled Before, he writes about Afghans who are trying to escape their country as its economy is collapsing. Nermeen Sheikh and I recently interviewed Matthew Akins. I began by asking him to answer a question he poses in his article. Who does the West consider worthy of saving?
Imagine right now if Ukrainians, instead of being allowed to cross freely into neighboring countries, into the EU, where they don't require visas, imagine if they were being forced to cross the mountains and sea with smugglers and risk their lives just to escape this war. And that, of course, is a situation for Afghans, as it was for Syrians, as it was for people in most conflicts in the world. They're caged in by these borders, they're not able to cross freely without visas. And when I went to Afghanistan this summer and fall, I went to the border with Iran and witnessed a new wave of Afghans who are displaced, who are fleeing their country, and spoke to a young couple there named Jawad and Shukriya, who are the subject of this article that you mentioned. And they had decided to escape the Taliban and were facing this deadly journey through the desert in order to reach safety. And that, unfortunately, is the situation for Afghans.
Matt, on the question of refugees and where Afghan refugees have been able to enter, the vast majority of which were in, of whom were in Afghanistan, in Pakistan and in Iran. But then more recently, it's been harder for them to even enter those countries.
Yeah, and they need visas in most cases, and they're not easy to get. The passport office wasn't working. This young woman, Shakria, didn't have a passport before the collapse, and so she couldn't get one. Even if they do have one, they can't get visas to the majority of countries. I mean, Afghans have one of the worst passports in the world when it comes to visa-free travel. And that's actually deliberate. These visa laws are put in place to keep out asylum seekers, which the West doesn't want. So it's very stark, the difference in treatment between the vast majority of refugees who need smugglers to escape and what's happening in Ukraine right now, which is, of course, good. People should be allowed to flee wars without having to resort to smugglers.
Matt, before we go to the situation, the political situation in Afghanistan now and, of course, later your book, if you could talk about the humanitarian crisis, as we said in the introduction, 75% of Afghanistan's population has now fallen into acute poverty, 5 million Afghans facing acute malnutrition, and the UN Secretary General warning that the country was hanging by a thread. Could you talk about what you know of the causes of this crisis and what you think needs to be done?
Well, one thing we have to understand is that there's been a malnutrition, a poverty crisis in Afghanistan for a long time. Poverty and malnutrition actually got worse during the U.S. occupation. Because of the conflict and because of the ineffectiveness of development and aid. But, of course, the collapse has made it far worse. You know, we, over 20 years, built the most aid-dependent state in the world, perhaps in history. And the sudden withdrawal of that aid has had predictable consequences. It's led to this near collapse of the government and a situation where people don't have enough to eat, where they're, in some cases, selling their children, you know, in very young marriages in order to survive, where they're fleeing across borders just to find jobs. So people are fleeing a catastrophe that we have direct responsibility for, but under the, you know, the refugee laws that we have today, that doesn't make them eligible for asylum. You know, someone fleeing starvation is not considered a refugee in the classic definition of the term, the Geneva Convention of 1951. And yet, that is absolutely what's driving a lot of Afghans to leave their country.
You said, Matt, that a humanitarian crisis is not grounds for Afghans or others seeking asylum refugee status. But in addition to the humanitarian crisis, there have been widespread reports of the Taliban cracking down on women activists, former members of the former government, as well as on journalists. I mean, are those people still trying to flee the country?
They are, but like I said, it's very difficult to leave. You know, people are facing risk of persecution. I have friends there. You know, every day I wake up to messages on my phone, people who are desperate to get out. It's very, very difficult for them to get visas and leave. And once they do, even if they can get to a neighboring country like Iran or Pakistan, they're looking at waiting years for refugee resettlement. But there's a lot of people who are trying to get them out. These are people who want to leave, who have people in the West who want to help them get out, support them. They're people we have a responsibility for due to our long involvement in the country and the mess we've left behind. And yet, again, because of visa restrictions, because of immigration laws, because of our, you know, man-made constraints, these people are trapped in a desperate situation. And so that's really, I think, what we should be aware of. And one of the things I wanted to, you know, explain in my book is just how much of the suffering and restrictions faced by refugees, faced by migrants, are the result of border policies, are the result of laws. And it really takes a case like Ukraine, where people are just leaving, you know, they're just getting in their car and driving to Poland, for us to see just how much of the suffering is actually unnecessary in places like Afghanistan.
Let's
take a deep dive into your book, because you tell this story so graphically. What happens to refugees, you know, those who are, quote, worth saving and those who aren't? Matthew Akin's book is called The Naked Don't Fear the Water, An Underground Journey with Afghan Refugees. We have a rule on Democracy Now!, Matt, and that is no sound bites. So you got to give us the whole meal here. Can you talk about the journey you took, the obstacles, the horror people face when they're fleeing a desperate situation, which is what you could describe Afghanistan, the country, as over the last decades of the U.S. invasion and occupation of Afghanistan? Talk about your journey.
Well, the story begins with my friend, whom I call Omar in the book. And Omar was, you know, one of the first people I met in Afghanistan when I went there, shortly after I went there in 2008. He had grown up in exile. His parents fled the Soviets. You know, we have to remember Afghanistan's been at war for 40 years now, tragically. And they came back after 2001 full of hope for the future of their country, for this era of development and peace that the West had promised to Afghans after the U.S. invasion. And he became a translator with the American military. He was also working for Canadians. He spoke English. Then he decided he wanted to work with journalists, so that's when we met. And we worked together for many years in the country while I was living in Afghanistan. I got to know his family as well. And like many Afghans, he dreamed of emigrating to the West. He actually applied for one of these special immigrant visas that the U.S. grants to employees, local employees in Afghanistan and Iraq. He should have qualified, but because of all the paperwork restrictions, he was rejected. So this happened in 2015 when, as you probably recall, there was a migration crisis in Europe. A million people crossed the Mediterranean Sea. It was the largest movement of refugees in history in these little rubber rafts. So the borders in Europe opened briefly, and Omar thought, this is my chance to go. So he decided to take the smuggler's road to Europe in order to escape, and I decided to go with him. But the only way that I could do that was to go undercover as an Afghan refugee myself, because of the danger of being kidnapped or being arrested and separated. And because my mother's ancestors are Japanese, but I look Afghan and I speak Persian from living there for so many years. So I was able to do that. So the book is a story of our journey together through the migrant underground to Europe.
So talk about the journey you took. Talk about where you started with your friend Omar and what you faced.
Well, it started in Kabul when he decided to go, and he was on the fence about leaving for a while because he'd fallen in love with, you know, a young woman, the neighbor's daughter, and he didn't want to leave and risk losing her. But ultimately, he realized that was the only way her father, who didn't want the marriage to happen, was going to give her hand, because he needed to go and have something to show he could bring her legally to Europe, perhaps. So he made the decision to set off, and we traveled to the border, the same place I was last fall. You know, this is the Iranian border. It's a desert between Iran and Afghanistan, and this is where migrants cross. It's a very dangerous journey. Takes you through wild terrain controlled by drug smugglers and insurgents. So we ended up in a smuggler's safe house there, and there were many twists and turns, which I guess I shouldn't get into here, but eventually we found ourselves in Turkey, and then from Turkey we went to the coast again with smugglers, and we were driven to the beach and deposited around midnight and told to get on board a little rubber raft. So there was about 40 people, men, women, and children, some of them Syrian, some Afghan, some African, but we were all together in this tiny boat that set off into the sea around midnight. And that was the crossing that many refugees made. In hopes of reaching safety on the Greek islands.
Matt, you said that Omar himself grew up in exile. He didn't grow up in Afghanistan. He and his family returned to Afghanistan in 2001 after the Taliban were ousted. Where did he grow up? And then also explain the role of smugglers, who they are, and the exorbitant sums they often charge people trying to flee.
Yeah. They do often represent, you know, life savings for people, these sums of money that they have to pay. And the more money you have, the safer your journey, and the less money you have, the more risks you're forced to take. But the fact of the matter is, as I mentioned, almost every refugee needs a smuggler because they're not allowed to cross borders. They come from countries normally that where their passports don't allow them to travel. So smugglers are a necessity. They're often scapegoated for the migration crisis, but in reality, they're created by borders. You know, the harsher a border is, the more difficult it is to cross, the more people are going to be willing to pay smugglers, the more of an economy it creates. And this is something Afghans have lived with for decades. You know, like I said, Omar grew up in Iran, and he and his family, you know, were also in Pakistan. They were on the move throughout his childhood, and very often they were crossing borders with the help of smugglers. And one of the things that I talk about in the book, that, you know, in terms of history, is how these borders have gotten more and more difficult to cross over time. So when they were fleeing the Soviets at that time, it was actually relatively easy to cross. In some places, you might just pay a small bribe to a border guard. But over the years, as neighboring countries have tried to keep out Afghan migrants, they've built walls, they've stepped up patrols, they've increased the violence of the borders. That's just meant that people have to pay more and go further, take deeper detours into the mountains. The bribes that are paid now have increased. The cost has increased, and yet people are still crossing. And yet, you know, there's been a massive wave. You know, when I was on the border this fall, I was told by the smugglers there that they've never seen this many people crossing. There was an estimate that maybe 1 million Afghans have crossed into Iran this fall. So the borders don't keep people out. They don't keep desperate people from moving, but they do enrich smugglers.
One of the things you exposed, Matt, was the drone strike at the very end, the last one that the world saw because all the world's media was there, though that had happened many, many, many times before throughout Afghanistan, where there weren't witnesses, where there weren't journalists, creating so many internal refugees who then ultimately are the refugees who try to leave the country. And I wanted to connect it to something that just happened a few weeks ago in the Senate. In January, the Senate Judiciary Committee held a hearing on the costs of 20 years of the U.S. drone strikes. The hearing began when the committee chair, Senator Dick Durbin, played a clip from Democracy Now! Of a Yemeni victim of a U.S. drone strike. Among those who testified was Hina Shamsi, the director of National Security Project for the ACLU, which represents survivors of the August 29th drone strike in Kabul that you so well documented, that killed 10 Afghan civilians.
I've listened to fathers describe the horror of having to pick up the body parts of their children. I've listened to one of my clients struggle to breathe through her despair after the killing of her husband, an aid worker for an American NGO, and three of her sons, and one of her grandchildren. My client's grief is compounded by the fact that for 19 days, our government kept up false allegations about their loved ones, wrongly asserting the strike was righteous and successful against ISIS operatives. The Pentagon later admitted its mistake, but the damage is done.
Hina Shamsi's testimony drew an angry response from the South Carolina Republican Senator Lindsey Graham, whose second biggest source of campaign contributions for his 2020 reelection campaign were employees of the major drone producer Lockheed Martin. This is Senator Graham.
Afghanistan is a breeding ground for terrorism as I speak. Everybody that we work with is being slaughtered. And we want to talk about limiting, closing Gitmo, and restricting the drone program. You're living in a world that doesn't exist.
So that's Lindsey Graham lecturing Hina Shamsi. Matt, can you describe the world that does exist as you saw it with the U.S. drone strikes in Afghanistan?
Well, yeah, I was there the next morning after this drone strike in Kabul, and I saw some body parts in the wreckage of the vehicle that the U.S. had destroyed inside a family home. Some of those body parts belong to the seven children who were killed in the strike. And as you mentioned, this strike was one of many. You know, this was well documented because it happened in Kabul at a time when the world's attention was focused. But there's countless strikes that have taken place in remote areas where people can't visit, and we just have the military's version of events. But, you know, the point is right now that we have a direct responsibility for what has happened in Afghanistan. There's no easy solutions. I don't think just sealing off the borders and bombing them with drones is in any way going to help the situation, and it's not reflective of the responsibility we bear. We should be, you know, working to actively alleviate the humanitarian crisis as best we can. Instead, we're cutting off the Afghan central bank's funds and seizing it, saying we're going to distribute it to the 9/11 families. So I think people would just like to turn their backs on Afghanistan and forget about them. But the truth is that we have much more responsibility for what Afghans are fleeing than Ukrainians, for example.
No, and if you could explain that last point, it's one that we have focused on a lot. But this issue, if we could end on these sanctions against the money. We had on a mother whose son was killed in the 9/11 attacks, Phyllis Rodriguez. And she said, not in her son's name. Does she want the people, the sons and daughters of Afghanistan, to suffer as her family has suffered losing him? This point of the sanctions put on the aid to Afghanistan that is preventing the people of Afghanistan from getting their money.
What we've done is we've frozen the deposits that the Afghan central bank had in U.S. banks, and that has completely crippled the financial system and exacerbated the terrible crisis that's happening in the country. And you know, to seize this money and say you're going to distribute it to the 9/11 families, to me is not only cruel but illogical, because this money doesn't belong to the Taliban, right? It belongs to the Afghan people. If we don't recognize the Taliban as a legitimate government of Afghanistan, which we haven't, then it's not their money. But it's clearly a policy that's being done for domestic reasons, for domestic political reasons, and I think it is sadly representative of an administration that clearly is not thinking about Afghans first.
Award-winning journalist Matthew Akins, author of the new book, The Naked Don't Fear the Water, An Underground Journey with Afghan Refugees. Oh, and this update. Earlier this week, the Biden administration designated Temporary Protective Status, or TPS, for Afghanistan, which will protect Afghan refugees from deportation for 18 months, including the 76,000 who fled after the U.S. military withdrawal and arrived here before March 15th. The move came about 2 weeks after Biden granted TPS to Ukrainians. And that does it for our show. Happy early birthday to Tammy Woronoff. Democracy Now! Is accepting job applications. You can go to democracynow.org. Democracy Now! Is produced with Renee Fels, Mike Burke, Dina Gezder, Messiah Rhodes, Nermeen Sheikh, Maria Terracena, Tammy Woronoff, Camille Baker, Trina Nadura, Sam Alkoff, Tamari Astudio, John Hamilton, Rabbi Karen, Honey Masood, Mary Conlon, Juan Carlos Davila. Special thanks to Julie Crosby. I'm Amy Goodman. Stay safe.